can't stay for tomorrow.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome AAPC Vice President Tom Shepard.
Welcome. The Hall of Fame inductions are my favorite part of the conference, and I mean in no way to minimize the importance of the Polly Awards and Campaign Excellence Awards, but this ceremony is different. It honors achievement not in one campaign or one particular effort, product, project. It is awarded for a body of work over an entire career. And I think it's important in a profession like ours that is as rapidly changing as ours is, a profession where we are constantly bringing in young people who are entering our profession and contributing to it. It's important at some point that we take a moment and remember our past. To honor the pioneers in our profession on whose shoulders all of us are standing right now. In addition, we have over the last several years given the Republican and Democratic caucuses an opportunity to recognize and induct those who we've lost. And so our first inductee today, this afternoon, is someone who we lost, who will be posthumously inducted into our Hall of Fame. Alan Hoffenblum, for those of you who are not from California, was a true pioneer, laid the foundation for modern politics, helped lay the foundation for modern politics in California. To induct Alan, I want to introduce to you Tom Shortridge, who is associate publisher of the California Target Book. Tom worked with Alan Hoffenblum for over 25 years until Alan's death in 2015, and he continues to be in charge of operations and sales for the California Target Book. Tom is a political consultant and a lobbyist based here in the South Bay, Los Angeles area. Tom Shortridge, would you like to come up?
We put together a little presentation today, so if they can just go ahead and play it, we've got some fun old pictures and videos, not videos, pictures and mailers to take a look at, and I'll come back up. One of the funny things I thought about when they were doing the introductions to this was when I first started working for Alan in his office in 1987 or 88, we worked on a Mac 512K, and we had an old machine called a Quip machine, which was before a fax machine, and our graphic artist brought in the color separations on vellum, and we used to run down to the printer and for a blue line and a color key, and probably half the people in this room have no idea what a blue line or a color key are. And so it's just funny to go and see the technology out in the other room today and seeing how this process started and how, two-color printing was like a big deal at the time. And when we first started to do full-color printing, it was amazing that we had the budget to do full-color printing for legislative and congressional races. So it was just interesting to see over that time period of, Alan's before retiring as a consultant, all the changes in the technology over that time. So just on behalf of the California Target Book, on Alan's sister, Janine, and all of us who have been his friends, and supporters over the years, just thank you on behalf of Alan Hoffenblum for the award.
For our second induction this afternoon, I'm very pleased to introduce the newest Republican member of the AAPC Board of Directors, Millie Hallow.
I think I'm the newest, the oldest, and the shortest, and that's why Becky nominated me. Our next inductee. He has mailed more than 4 billion letters, billion with a B, in his 50 plus years of direct mail marketing. Your little sheet says, and it's worth reading, he transformed American politics in the 1960s and the 1970s by pioneering the use of computerized direct marketing in political and ideological spheres. And he was key in getting Ronald Reagan elected as the first conservative president in the modern era. All of that is really true, but he's done so much more. And for the quantitative stuff, for those of you that have not heard of Richard Viguerie, just Google it. But I want to say something more. He has literally motivated millions of Americans to participate in politics for the first time. And I love this quote. It's an old quote from Remember George magazine, but it's perfect. Richard is our era's equivalent to Tom Paine, using a direct mail letter instead of a pamphlet to deliver his call to arms. And that was really true in the 60s and 70s. His methods and the methods used by his imitators made the spread of conservative activists and thereby conservatism possible. And he forever changed the landscape of the political landscape and changed the landscape for political consultants as well. He's an author. He's written multiple books. His latest is Takeover, the 100-Year War for the Soul of the GOP and How Conservatives Can Finally Win It, showing us he's still in the battle, writing his columns, his books, running his organizations, using every old school and new modern tool to connect. But what I find the most endearing, Richard, and I say this to you as if we're the only ones in the room, and why I'm so thrilled too, that you're being honored at AAPC are your human qualities, his character. He is, yes, a staunch, unbending, some say ruthless conservative who does not hesitate to go for the jugular in his mailings, columns, and writings, but who in person is one of the kindest, most generous, and modest people I know, whose political opponents to a one talk about his integrity and his class. Let me say that again. Whose political opponents talk about his integrity and class. Quick anecdote. Richard is a longtime attendee of Renaissance Weekend. This is a gathering of mostly liberals founded by Bill Clinton's ambassador to the Court of St. James, Phil Lader. Ralph, my husband, and I have been going to Renaissance for about 10 years. Richard's been going 20, 30 years. We're very much outnumbered as conservatives. Maybe 1,800 to 10, literally. But here's what I learned from Richard. Real friendships have flourished there. I learned from Richard how to keep my views and my principles intact, speak my mind but not blow my lid, and yet be open to friendships and ideas. And what I would hear, never from Richard, but from other folks, is that as people became ill or had problems, even lay dying, it would be Richard, after the family, that came to spend time and hold a dying person's hands. I could tell you names of folks across the aisle for whom he did that, but I won't, because that's not how Richard rolls. And here's my scandalous gossip about Renaissance. His best friend was and is Dr. Ruth Westheimer, the sex expert. And believe me, they have a great time on New Year's Eve singing and bringing in the New Year's together. And for me, I want to bring this symbolism to AAPC because it's how it symbolizes to me about how ideas, ideologies can differ, but as human beings, we can connect in so many other ways. So it's my honor to be part of this announcement of my legendary darling friend, Richard Viguerie. He more than deserves this honor. But Richard, I know you would never forgive me if I didn't say this. You never forget what's important. The fact that you and Elaine just celebrated your 55th wedding anniversary last week. And attended by your three children and the loves of your lives, your six grandchildren. And so, Richard, before we call you up, I've got a couple of friends that wanted to say something to you. Can we roll the video? Can we start it over with volume, please?
Understand copywriting.
What can one say about my good friend Richard Viguerie?
Truth is, I couldn't have got my institute off the ground without what I learned from Richard.
Richard Viguerie was probably the greatest political copywriter in American history. And if you understand copywriting, you understand political communication.
I think the thing about Richard, he's a man of integrity, sharp mind, able to get to the heart of a particular issue very, very quickly, very easily.
You were the catalyst that allowed conservatism to reach the pinnacles that it has over these past many years.
He's one of the genuine pioneers of modern American politics. Fact is, he really invented the use of direct mail by Republicans and by conservatives.
A man who deserves the recognition, the applause for what he's done over the years.
Richard has been making a difference, a big difference, a profound difference, not only in fundraising, but American politics for decades.
Even if he had not decided to go public, his prowess would have made him a public figure.
That have left their print on every aspect of the conservative movement from its infancy to today. But Richard's much more than that, a champion of criminal justice reform.
Your life has been a major contributor to our society.
Without any doubt, Richard Viguerie is the founding father of the conservative movement.
You were on the ground floor with Yaff, with Reagan, with Goldwater. You were there with your envelopes and your stamps and a fast tongue that sent out thousands and thousands to people to raise money that allowed conservatism to be such a powerful force in today's politics.
Richard Viguerie really is the godfather of the conservative movement. Long before we had the internet, it was Richard Viguerie who devised a way for conservatives to communicate, raise money, and mobilize.
The causes that he supported, he's been able to help them gain notoriety and influence.
He is a genuine pioneer, somebody who went out, figured out some very complicated things, and then applied them to a cause he believed in, a cause that I'm proud to have worked with him on.
He sought out other talented, principled people and has worked tirelessly with them. But when he fights in the public policy process, his weight is always felt.
An iconoclast who deals with and enjoys people who agree with him and disagree with him. A man with a heart so big that it's hard to compare with anyone else.
Richard has something of a reputation for being a hard-nosed businessman, but I could relate to you many true stories of how Richard has leapt to the assistance of any of his employees who were hurt or in danger.
Those people, those young men and women of YAF, were encouraged by you, and you helped make it all happen.
Richard was somebody who would say, this is what I believe in. This is where I think we ought to go. Let's stick to it, and hopefully we can make a difference that way.
His steadfast belief in his principles and his willingness to stand up for them in any forum.
You, sir, are a man that are responsible for conservative principles of limited government, personal responsibility, and liberty.
In 1963, I was elected to the National Board of Young Americans for Freedom, and you and I, we were together at the first national board meeting that I attended, and then you asked for a raise, but the board decided, no, we think Richard's making plenty of money, so they voted against it. I happily was one of the people that voted for it, by the way.
I admire most about him that he is there when you need him. He is a friend that you can go to for advice and counsel.
I am proud to join all your friends to salute you, sir, for your service, for your contribution, for your wisdom.
Richard, congratulations. You deserve everything you get.
I raise a glass and toast to Richard Viguerie.
Richard, you've got many, many years ahead of you, and I'm just glad to have had you as a friend.
Richard, congratulations.
Anyone who works with Richard learns early and learns well. Never, ever call him Dick.
Come on up, Richard.
Thank you, Millie. Thank the AAPC board. There's an old saying, it's not original with me, but Dad would have really, really enjoyed this. Mother would have believed every word. quite frankly, as great an honor as this is, you too can be up here one day. All you got to do is just outlive everybody else, you know. Eat your fruit, your vegetables, a lot of seafood, don't smoke, and you can be up here. I can kind of envision a board meeting a few months ago and trying to find somebody to receive this prestigious award this year. And Millie says, well, what about Richard Viguerie? Millie, are you sure he's still alive? Can you assure us he's still living? I'm quite surprised. Most people in this room have spent their adult life trashing, bashing the other side. I'm a little different. I've trashed and bashed everybody here. it is true. I wrote a book, as Millie said, a few years ago called Takeover, and it deals with what I consider the most important political battle in America, which is not between Republicans and Democrats. It's inside the Republican Party. I consider that the most important political battle. And some of you maybe remember a popular book years ago called Everything I Learned in Kindergarten. Well, us conservatives feel that Republican consultants, most of them, not all, but most of them, everything they learned about politics, they learned in 1964. Barry Goldwater, whose son we just saw on the screen, was a conservative. He ran for president in 64 as a conservative. He lost in a landslide. Ergo, anybody runs as a conservative nationally can't win. These consultants, Republicans, have no recollection of 1980, 1984, 1994, 2010, 2014, 2016. So the it's very, very frustrating. So that's why I've been bashing, a bipartisan basher and trasher. And I do believe that there's an important battle taking over in the Republican Party and taking place in the Republican Party. And it's being played out very big time in the Trump administration. 1961, I started doing the pioneer work that had been alluded to and mentioned by some of the people on the screen there. And I began to be criticized by people on the Republican side, the old right conservatives, Democrats, the media, and it really picked up speed big time in the 1970s. And regularly, I'm attacked on NBC, ABC, CBS, New York Times, Time Magazine, Washington Post, big, big attacks. And all of the attacks, they were attacking me and all the work that we were doing to get the grassroots organized through direct mail. And all of the attacks stopped within a few hours. Election night, November 1980. Collectively, you could hear the Republicans, Democrats, old right, the media say, aha, that's what Vigory has been up to. And so the left ran out there real quick like and tried to duplicate what we had been doing, organizing at the grassroots, raising money from millions of people at the grassroots level. And I told all my conservative friends, don't worry, don't worry. It's taken me 17 years or so to do this, and it's going to take the left 20 or more years. I'm smarter than they are, you know. Not so. Within 3 or 4 years, the left had caught up with the conservatives. In my opinion, today, the left does a far better job of direct marketing, whether that's direct mail, the internet, etc., than the conservatives do. And a lot of that pioneering work was done initially by Roger Craver, a previous awardee winner of this award that I got today. Roger brought the liberals into the 20th century with marketing. And so to this day, I think the left still does a far better job. And one of the reasons is that I wouldn't dream of flying in an airplane with a pilot who had the skills of the average person in nonprofit marketing. I've learned very little from the nonprofit community, most from the commercial world. At my tender age of 83, I spend 2.5 to 3 hours every day studying marketing. There's a lot of young people here today, and I commend you, you know, to study the giants who have come before, and giants have come before. When I started, I was memorizing, you know, the David Ogilvies of the world out there. And there are people in whatever profession or whatever aspect of campaign you're involved in, there are giants who have come before you. Study, 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 read, read, read. And by the way, those of you who focused on the internet, that's important, but in terms of fundraising, the workhorse is still direct mail. That's going to change, but it's going to take 10, 12 years. Right now, the workhorse is still direct mail. And those nonprofits that are relying entirely on the internet to raise their money are not going to be in business very long. And then that'll change, but it's going to be a significant way down the road. Disruption, we all know, has come to American business. Kids in their parents' garage and basements disrupting Fortune 500 companies. That disruption has come to education. It's now come to American politics. On the left, on the right, in Europe. The world is changing. I don't have the foggiest idea how it's going to look in 5 years from now, but I do know that 5 years from now, politics is going to look significantly different than it does now, perhaps radically different. So be prepared. It is going to change. Excuse me. One of two people are going to change your business. Either you're going to change it or your competitor is going to change it. You saw Dr. Lee Edwards on the screen there. He is 001. I call myself sometimes jokingly as 002, which means I've been active at the national level of the conservative movement longer than every living conservative except Dr. Lee Edwards. At 83, I go 13, 14 hours a day, 5.5 days a week. Do not know the name of anyone at any age that keeps up with me. We have 75 employees, and we're growing and expanding, and we have to run very fast every day just to stand still. But all of this activity I get from my role model, and my role model is Moses. And Moses, Deuteronomy 34, chapter, verse 7, and Moses lived to be 120. And his eye was not dim, nor his vital forces abated. Moses lived his life in three 40-year compartments. First 40 years, of course, in the house of the Pharaoh. Second 40 years in the wilderness, his father-in-law Jethro. Last 40 years is when he became the leader of the Israelites. So when Moses turned 80, it's just when he got started. So look out, liberals. Vigory is just getting started. Thank you. Thank you.
Our next presenter needs no introduction, and therefore I'm not going to give him an introduction. Please welcome my friend, Doc Schweitzer.
How the hell do you follow that? It's an honor. I'm going to talk about my mentor and business partner, Paul Tully. I can't quote Moses, but I will say Paul was our Moses because he was the heart and soul of the Democratic Party for operatives for years. If you say the word Tully to my entire generation, people have a story or just break into laughter about it because he was such a character. In fact, Jessica and I were talking. Paul's been gone 25 years. 5 years ago, we had a meeting in Washington to tell Tully stories. That's 20 years after his death, and 175 people show up. I mean, most of the people in this room aren't going to draw 175 the first time they die. But 20 years later, Paul's still packing the house, and we're telling Tully stories. If you met him, you were lucky. If you worked with him, you were changed. In 1 hour, Paul could teach you more about politics and what was important than anybody else I've met. Paul was an offensive lineman at Yale, All-American offensive lineman at Yale. In fact, one of the great stories to get a sense of his passion for social justice, if you screwed up or you were a bad person or you picked on anybody at Yale, Paul, you'd get a knock on the door, and Paul would be there, and he'd say, "Did you do this?" And you go, "Yeah." Boom, one punch and you were down. And it was known as a Tullygram. And they were sent throughout the campus, Tullygrams. He went on to the University of Pennsylvania and got a law degree. So here's a guy that's a lot smarter than most people in the business. But instead of following a law career, making a lot of money, his passion was the Democratic Party, and particularly presidential elections. For 8 presidential elections, he was right in the middle of them, in the heart and soul of those campaigns. He achieved a dream, his dream of electing a Democratic president as a political director of the DNC in 1992 with Bill Clinton. And to get a sense of how important he was to that, Bill Clinton talked about two people the night of the election in Little Rock. He talked about James Carville and Paul Tully. Unfortunately, Paul did not get to see that. He passed away several weeks beforehand. But Paul's greatest achievement was his teaching and his training. He was passionate about it. He gave the best training seminars of anybody. He was animated. He hit all the right buttons. So he left thousands of people around this country. He trained in messaging and in budgeting and in targeting the Democratic operatives. The other thing he did is he left an entire generation of what we call disciples, because we're all disciples of Paul. I'd say about half the Democratic consultants of my generation worked with Paul at some point. I mean, Steve Murphy, Saul Shore, Donna Brazile, Teresa Valmaine, Will Robinson, Joe Trippi. It goes on and on and on. We were inspired by Paul. He taught us the lessons, and he taught us the passion of it. So, and just in closing, I mean, he was simply the best. He was passionate about this, but I have to tell you the real Paul Tully that we all know. Paul was just like a walking bear. He was disheveled at all times. He drank 14 cups of coffee a day. He smoked cigarettes, and he talked in grunts and groans. But you got him. He just because his passion, it was there. You knew exactly how Paul felt and what was going on. So just one cute story. Paul was negotiating for Mondale with Jesse Jackson for a get out the vote effort. It's not going particularly well, but Paul comes out of the room to smoke a cigarette, and out comes walking down the hall is Mondale, who's about as straight-laced as you can be, and Mike Ford, who was Paul's partner in crime, and Mondale says, "How are the negotiations going?" And Paul looked at him and he said, "They said, fuck you." And he said, "What?" He said, "What did you say?" He said, "Fuck me? No, fuck you." That was Paul, the fighter to the end. The heart and soul of the Democratic Party, a mentor to all of us. You know, we could fill a room this big again tomorrow with people that just want to tell stories about the great Paul Tully. I'm very blessed to know him, and he meant a lot to me. Thank you.
When I first met Paul Tully, he was already a superstar in the Democratic firmament. As the New York Times wrote in his rather lengthy obituary, Mr. Tully was among the most impassioned and intense of a generation of Democratic political professionals who devoted much of their lives to regaining the White House. He worked in every presidential election since 1968. Paul was raised in a family of union activist plumbers and Manhattan skyline pipe fitters, steam fitters. He and his sister were the first in their family to go to college, as Doc said, Yale, and then where as a standout football star, and then at Penn Law School. He volunteered for Robert Kennedy and Eugene McCarthy. He worked as an advance man for George McGovern in 1972. He was a senior strategist for Mo Udall in 1976, for Ted Kennedy in 1980, for Mondale Ferraro in 1984. He was Gary Hart's second or third campaign hire. In 1987, he joined Michael Dukakis's campaign. But it was in 1990 when he and I first met. He was the political director of the Democratic National Committee under the then chair, the late Ron Brown. Most of you don't remember those days. At my age, I have trouble remembering them too, even though I was there. But George Bush, the father, had just won the first Gulf War against Iraq and had an approval rating of 89%, the highest anyone's ever had. But Paul Tully was sure of four things. First and most important, that Democrats could win the White House 2 years hence. Second, that we need to train a whole new generation of organizers and operatives. Third, that we needed to use modern polling and analysis to build campaigns in a scientific way. And fourth, that we needed a candidate to run in order to win. Paul and Teresa Valmaine organized training academies around the country. A group of us would trundle off every week or so to cities around the country to train that next generation. The highlight of those training academies was, as Doc noted, Paul's presentation on strategy and message. Participants really sat in rapt attention, watching Paul pace around the stage, trying to interpret grunts and groans and eyebrow lifts. But they did figure it out. Newbies and veterans alike all learned some vitally important lessons. Paul taught us how to use something that he invented, the message box, the Tully box. Many of you probably have used a message box, something that Paul Tully invented. He taught us about using computers and maps to to analyze targeting data, which were then wholly new ideas. He taught us how to integrate targeting and media buying and so much else. Paul, as I said, also knew we needed a candidate. And when, frankly, those candidates, potential candidates, were looking at George Bush's 89% approval rating, there weren't a lot of them like jumping forward to say, me, I'll run. So Paul, and I in some cases with him, met with candidate after candidate, potential candidate after potential candidate, most of whom demurred. At Paul's urging, two decided pretty early on to go forward. One was the late Paul Tsongas, the other was Bill Clinton. When Bill Clinton got the nomination, Paul moved to Little Rock, where he literally worked himself to death. At 10 a.m., Paul was pretty rarely available. 12, 1 a.m., 2 a.m., you could get him easily, anytime. When Paul died in his Little Rock hotel room just about 7 weeks before achieving his dream, Ron Brown, then the DNC chairman, said this: "There'll only be one Paul Tully, pacing, driven, full of joy. Paul's commitment to our party, and more importantly, to making this a great nation, even great, making this great nation even greater, was a fire that burned bright." Soon to be President Bill Clinton said Paul had one of the nation's greatest political minds and its biggest hearts. James Carville, this guy's whole life was presidential politics. He'd worked on this for years. He had every map, every target. He probably knew the name of every swing voter in the country. And Paul left behind a bevy of Democratic pros who adored him as a teacher, as a mentor, as a friend. And he also left behind his two greatest accomplishments, Jessica and Miranda Tully, his daughters. Jessica is with us today, and we want to, in a moment, call her up, but first see a few other people talk about Paul Tully.
I always thought of myself as a schmuck trying to figure out what's going on. All right. And sometimes you figure out what's going on, and sometimes you don't.
Paul Tully lit up this world with an intensity and purpose that few have ever matched or exceeded.
I mean, he was all politics all the time.
It really wasn't a game to him. It was how to make people's lives better in a real way and have real impact in a real short period of time.
He was a force of nature.
I think many of us that have continued on and sort of worked in politics really hold a lot of the lessons we learned from Paul Tully to our hearts.
I remember once saying to him that I was a hack, and he got really mad, and he said, "No, you're a political organizer, and your work is your vocation, and you believe in change, and it's noble. It's a noble profession."
I walked into this room. It was full of people, full of a lot of women, and there was this madman at the front, really gesticulating and talking about politics and organizing and this election, and I thought, wow, I'm home.
Have a phone call, send him a letter, right? Contacts where you candidates aren't there.
For those of us who were not party people, made us feel like the Democratic Party had something to offer.
President Clinton always says, "We'd never be here if it hadn't been for Tully." And that was the truth.
I will always remember Paul Tully as somebody who was tolerant, somebody who was open, a man who had probably the biggest heart.
He not only worked hard, knew how to organize, but he believed in what he did. And he believed in the progressive causes that we all have worked for over the past.
If any of us in our lifetimes can ever touch as many people and make as much of an impact on life as he did, we will be so incredibly lucky.
I guess I think what's amazing is that there are still so many of us who feel so deeply what he felt and still think that his ideals are the ideals that are important today.
Some men see things as they are and say, "Why?" I dream things that never were and say, "Why not?" That was Robert Kennedy, but it was Paul Tully too.
We are a party and we are a country in need of ideas. What matters? What's at stake? The school at the end of the street has a class size 45 or a class size 30. The air is breathable or not. The drugs are coming in overwhelmingly or not. What are the tangible differences that matter as to who's in charge of this government?
Ladies and gentlemen, Jessica Tully.
Thank you. Amazing. Oh, yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Wow. Thank you, guys. Wow, thanks so much. This is really incredible, and thank you to the AAPC and under Mark's leadership. It's really exciting that after 25 years, there's just so much interest in my dad's work, and it's just stunning to us and my whole family, and we really thank you. I'll just, a few little words, couple minutes here, I'll give you a little indication of what it was like being raised by a guy like that. Certainly speech writing, was not part of the training. So, work with me, if you will, or speech in general. Like many kids of divorced parents, I would spend summers with my dad and my little sister, Miranda. And we always had 2 weeks of family beach time. That was great. But the rest of the summer was spent in campaign offices, in boiler rooms, in conference rooms, in campaign training camps, and conventions. And because my birthday was in July, I literally thought that the balloon drop at the Democratic National Convention was like for my birthday. And I got the bug. All this was happening, and I would, as he would talk, I would sit close by and just draw. Our summers weren't just like take our daughters to work day, it was take our daughters to work month. Whether we were in Philadelphia with Doc or Washington, D.C., these summers were hot and they were muggy and they were focused on ideas and campaigns, not on vacations. And the reason was, he thought, it mattered. It really, really mattered. It made a tangible, as we saw in the video, it made a tangible difference who was in charge of this government. We were a party and a country in need of ideas. And what was at stake? Like he said, the school at the end of the street either has a class size 45 or a class size 30. Whether the air is breathable or not. And now we know, we are here from Oakland, whether the kids are using inhalers or can actually breathe. So on my summer visits, I would go wherever he went. And whatever city we were in, no matter where it was, we would walk everywhere. And it was 90 degrees and muggy because we were usually on the East Coast. He loved DC for the very fact that there was a municipal budget for flowers. This guy, this walking bear, loved the flowers. And that he loved in Washington, D.C., where many of you are from, that they would change the flowers weekly. He absolutely loved that as he walked from his apartment in Capitol Hill to the Democratic National Convention headquarters, also on Capitol Hill. But he would take a very particular route, and he would leave at a very particular time when he was ready, in the afternoon, after having worked usually until 3 or 4 in the morning. He would take a route that would show the most flowers, but also making sure not to walk past the Capitol as Congress was letting out, especially the House side. He didn't much care for the House members, but he loved, the governors and the senators. And if he didn't, really time this well, and it was before we had phones and knew, when things were happening, if he didn't time this well, he would never get out because folks would stop him and need to talk with him and gain his advice on whatever race and whatever fight that they were in. We were used to in those days in the 80s and 90s a lot of losing. Mark brought up who the candidates were that he worked for. It was always the most progressive candidate who could win, and he would go work for them. And yes, that meant a lot of losing at first. And U.G. McCarthy, George McGovern, Mo Udall, remember Mo Udall, and Walter Mondale and Geraldine Ferraro, and this is around about the time that I was, a young woman, and I met all these organizers at that time, especially the Teresa Vilmains and the Joyce Deeps of the world and Donna Brazil, who makes incredible mixtapes. She's got great, she influenced my DJ selections, really. These are the people that I met on the campaign trail and are mentors and to this day. It was, his scene, there was always a bank of televisions in the background playing, at that time, all three of the network simultaneously, so he can really, really see what was happening and how the news was handling and how the stories were being told. Message was key. And having a bank of televisions in a boiler room, that was his natural, natural habitat. And then came Ron Brown. And they, in so many ways, they were direct opposites. He was rumpled, as we heard many stories, and Ron was smooth. And he helped Ron, helped elect Ron to be the first person of color to be the chairman of the Democratic National Committee. And together, they were about the work to expand participation and not limit it, building towards a real democracy for all economic brackets, where participation and democracy is not limited by the access to voting machines, or purging of voting rolls, or the intentional gutting of the 1965 Voting Rights Act. So he was not about the profit from this work. Rather, the profit he sought was justice and equality for working men and women. I'll just leave you with, he was in this, we heard about this, he was this incredible trainer. If you could, decipher, some of these charts and what have you. But he also uplifted a legion of amazing young men and women, some of whom we saw in the videos, and legions more. That we saw in that great video that GMMB put together. So thank you, Jim, and the folks who worked on that. He also trained me. And I am an artist, and I'm an organizer, and I work every day to help inform and inspire other cultural workers and recording artists and visual artists and poets and millennials and especially young women to persist and to shape the world, because it matters. I spoke to him on September 23rd, the day before we got the terrible news. And he was happy. He was the happiest I had ever, ever heard him. And he knew, 6 weeks before the election, that Bill Clinton had the votes to win. And he knew that the country was going to become a little bit more fair for a lot more people. And that, as we go back to the idea of what matters, it mattered whether the government is trying to restrict voting rights or expand voting rights. It matters when politicians seek to limit reproductive freedom, taking on climate change, perhaps the most critical issue of our time, and time is ticking, as you all know. Some of you know. Matters. Truth and accuracy matter. And the example of my dad's life just reminds us that politics matters. Elections matter. Participation, justice, economic equality, protecting the planet, building racial justice, all of this matters in the lives of real people. And it is darkest before the dawn. And we need all of us to truly just take a look at our work before profits and ask, how does this matter? Thanks.
Thank you very much, Jessica, for those beautiful words. And as Jessica said, politics matters. Paul Tully mattered. Our next honoree also matters a great deal. Our next honoree is Gail Kaufman. Gail has been my friend and my teacher for, let's just say, about 25 years, roughly speaking, so nobody's getting too much information on our age. She, too, was a superstar and a pioneer when I first met her. After winning races up and down California, then Assembly Speaker Willie Brown appointed her Director of Assembly Majority Services. For those of you who aren't so familiar with California politics, that was like being a caucus director on a vast amount of steroids before there were caucus directors in other states. She served over 100 assembly and Senate and congressional races in this state and has won scores of ballot initiatives. I had the privilege of working with her to stop private school vouchers, protect labor unions' ability to pursue political objectives, to pass the largest school bond issue in human history, and in 2005, work with her to defeat four ballot measures backed by Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, for which the AAPC awarded her the Campaign Manager of the Year. Just last year, Gail legalized marijuana in California and kept in place an income tax hike on the wealthiest California. In fact, every cycle since 1998 has featured a Gail Kaufman initiative campaign in California. Gail wins those races because she is smart as a whip and tough as nails. She can't help but see 3, 4, 5, 10 steps down the road. Gail is the best, and she demands the best from everyone around her. I don't think she's ever gotten the first draft of a poll or the first draft of a script without saying, this needs a lot of work. David Crabb, am I right about that? I hope I'm not the only one. I'm pretty sure I'm not. Gail recognizes everything can be made better, and she insists everything she is involved with is the best it can be. Of course, some things are born perfect, like her son David, husband Steve, and we're delighted they're here, along with her entire staff, for this very special occasion. Gail is a model of hard work, of brilliant strategizing, of effective leadership, of ethical practice, and of being a wonderful wife, mother, daughter, and friend. It's a model we would all do well to emulate. We'll see a few more folks.
Gail Kaufman may very well be the most wonderful individual you could ever want to meet and interact in the world of politics.
Hardworking, loyal, well-informed, good contacts, follows through. She's just been an amazing person to learn from.
She's a fierce opponent and a very loyal friend. She demands the best. She insists on quality, and rightly so. Her clients are trusting her with their best interests, with their futures, and with their fortunes. And she delivers for them.
She's a mensch. You know, you can trust her, you can take her word to the bank, and if she tells you she's gonna beat you, you better watch out, because she's probably gonna beat you.
Gail's tough. I often couldn't get her to laugh when we're on the opposing sides of things. But that's part of that intense focus and discipline, and I think the success speaks for itself. I was always much more relieved when we could collaborate on things. That's a much better place to be.
Gail is one of the top political consultants as a woman, but then she's always making sure that she's helping other women succeed and be good at what we're doing.
She is never willing to rest on her past successes. She's always looking for solutions to problems that aren't cookie cutter. She's always focused on trying to win and doing whatever it takes to win, and she works really hard. And I truly admire that.
Gail, my heartfelt congratulations to you. You deserve it. You're the best.
As an adversary and colleague, I think it is very well deserved. I'm very happy for you.
This is an honor that's very rightly deserved. And the best part, it's not posthumous.
We look forward to many, many more years of good efforts in working together.
Gail, you're one of the chingonas in my life. Thank you for all the advice you've given me over the years and for your heartfelt encouragement every single day of my life.
I just hope you're not done yet. You have too much to offer.
Congratulations, Gail. Don't tell anybody what it really cost you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Gail Kaufman.
Wow. Well, thank you, everyone here who had anything to do with my being here today. That video really kind of surprised me and knocked me out. Several of the people on it in particular who was a little surprised to hear say some of the lovely things they have rarely said to my face. So I'm a little shocked. And I apologize ahead of time. I'm just coming off of a rather bad cold. This is a tremendous honor. It's a particularly tremendous honor to be on the stage today with the three other honorees. Mr. Vigory, I have read your books and tried to steal as much of it as I could over the years. You are an amazing, amazing pioneer, and I only hope I ever was able to do anything like what you were able to in my direct mail world, and certainly not on the fundraising side, I'll tell you that. I met Paul very shortly before he passed away, and so I had the honor of working with him ever so briefly. And but I knew the millions of people like you spoke of who loved him and adored him. And what can I say about Alan, the curmudgeon? You saw his materials up on the screen about Willie Brown and some of my mentors. But he was irascible, and he did an incredible job. So thank you so much for including me in this group. Mark, it is a tremendous pleasure to have you up on the stage with me, because Mark and I, he said 25 years, one of my, well, my first big initiative campaign was with Mark, the 226 campaign in 1998, and I can remember many nights sitting in the back of focus groups trying desperately to figure out the way to go. We have been on just about every big campaign together, and you've taught me so much and helped me become the strategist and the person, I think, in a lot of ways that I've become over the years. So I appreciate so much your handing me the award. I'm one of those lucky people who knew at 14 what I wanted to do when I grew up. And not how I was going to do it, or if I'd be successful at it, but from that early age, I always knew that I wanted to be involved in politics, and that it would be my life's passion. I credit our family dinners, my grandfather's union enthusiasm and activism, my older sister's political activism in college, for the beginning of that understanding. My story, I know, is similar to just about everybody's in this room in some fashion. You started as an organizer where you grew up. You got picked up on a campaign, in my case, a national campaign at 17. And you got to do things that you couldn't believe you were being asked to do. You got to travel. No one told you how to do anything. They expected you to figure it out as you went along, and you just did. You hoped that people explained stuff, or that you could ask questions, and that they would be nice enough or not think your questions were too stupid. In my case, very early on, they asked you to do African American Advance in Pensacola, Florida. Go figure out why. I never could, but I did it. And I kept moving on. In that same year, I got to actually go to my first national convention, and I watched Willie Brown stand and ask for his delegation back. And it was an amazing experience. And if I wasn't already hooked before, I was hooked then. I didn't realize then how much our lives would be intertwined later, but boy, they were. Our stories are similar in this way.
No one knew what a political consultant was, really, in those days. If you said that that's what you wanted to be, or you talked about that, my father could never explain what that meant to people until he saw it on TV many, many years later. It wasn't a thing. It wasn't that, just, it wasn't. You were an organizer. You did what you did, but you weren't a political consultant. That wasn't even heard of. We were always behind the scenes, and that was good enough for us to make things happen, to work and hopefully win without becoming part of the story, to let the candidate or the issue that we were working on get the glory. As long as what we were fighting for won, we were good. We learn by doing, we learn by asking and watching, being fortunate enough to work with some of the best who came before us. We knew we had politics in our blood. We ate it, we drank it, we slept it. That was everything. We couldn't understand why everyone wasn't more interested in it. We wanted to be the best at it, and we tried really hard to figure out how to do that. In my case, I got to spend a whole lot of time with Willie Brown. To him, I owe so much of this. He not only is someone I consider to be my mentor, but I consider him to be as close as a member of my family. He was the master of the inside game, and I was lucky enough to sit in the room on many occasions and watch him do what he did. And I was even fortunate enough, and I still am fortunate enough, to be able to call him and say, I'm thinking about doing this this way. Does that make sense to you? Or why did you do that way? And he actually would answer me and help me. And he's one of the few people I can say that all the way along the way really was there for me in my business and in my personal life. And so I owe him so very much. And his brilliant mind is something that I was so fortunate to be a part of. When I started Kaufman Campaigns in 1987, I had no idea what the hell I was doing. I didn't have a business plan. I actually still don't have a business plan. I didn't even know you were supposed to have a business plan. I remember years later saying, let me see your business plan. What's a business plan? I didn't know another women-owned political consulting firm to call and ask about how to do things. One of the people who I trusted the most, when I told him I was going to start my own business, told me I would never make it. So when I had the opportunity, my first opportunity, I went out and I beat him. And, you know, that was the end of that. There weren't a lot of women. I know some of the reason I'm up here today is because, as one of the few women-owned businesses in California with the kind of opportunities we've had. I represent an awful lot of other women who have a similar story to mine. But to be honest, there weren't a lot of women I could ask questions, and there really weren't a lot of women doing what I was trying to do in those days. There are now, thank God. I've tried to be a mentor and an advisor to so many, and I know so many of you are as well. But the truth is, there weren't a lot of political consultants. So we all had to kind of figure it out as we went along. I'm thrilled that that it's changing, but it was a long time in coming. And for all of that time, I was one or maybe two women in a room, and I had to figure it out, and hopefully that changes and continues to change and get better as time goes on. When I started, I was working out of my house, then a tiny office. I turned down business that didn't feel good to my gut. I took on clients I thought were righteous. Through some luck, a few good wins out of the gate on races that really no one expected me to win, and a whole lot of work, I muscled through. Clients like the SEIU and the California Teachers Association hired me early on in my career, and thank God for them. I have a lot of thanks to give in that regard as well. Terry Holloman is here today representing the California Teachers Association, and would you raise the sign that you gave us just because of the irreverence and love that they sent me? Together, CTA and many of the unions in California and I, starting with the 226 campaign in 98 and through the Prop 55 campaign of this year, have spent a whole lot of time in a whole lot of rooms planning and scheming and plotting for people throughout the state of California, and I hope that they all know how grateful I am for the opportunities they've given me to figure out how to win campaigns for them and for the working men and women of California. In the 226 campaign, I honestly believe I got that campaign because no one else wanted it at that moment. No one could figure out, no one thought we had a chance to win. I hired Dawn Legans as my media consultant. No one could believe there were two women running that campaign way back then. Mark was our pollster. We did an incredible job, and we took on Grover Norquist, and wow, that was a great way to start my initiative career. In 1991, my son David was born, and I started a new chapter in my life. Single motherhood. David, who is here today, can attest, just like the Tully family, to being in more focus groups than any one child should ever have been forced to be in, to be in every state convention, whether it was in a stroller or whatever, being carted off to any number of meetings along the way. But I hope that along the way, he at least got my passion for whatever he decides he's going to do in his life. He has been a joy and such a blessing, and I'm so happy that you're here today. I wasn't sure that David had caught the bug until my last campaign, which Mark mentioned, the weed campaign. Somehow. And in a year like this, I mean, aren't you glad that we legalized weed? Think about it. But anyway, until then, David hadn't really shown much of a compunction for going into my business, but he did work on that campaign, and he did a hell of a job. And we were successful, and it was one of the more complicated, difficult, unusual campaigns, I have to say, that I've been involved in. Two last things. Later than most people, sorry, I found my soulmate, someone who could actually put up with me and keep as singularly focused, as difficult, as tough as I could be. We met cute. Our kids were at a sleepover at Sutter's Fort, and we were in period costume as the parents. Hard to imagine, I know, but I had even a little bonnet on. Today, almost 15 and a half years later, Steve Murakami is still putting up with me, and I love him for that. And with Steve came his two beautiful children, Michael and Sean, who I love dearly as well. My husband, Steve, is here with me. My entire staff, it was mentioned, flew in and surprised me today. And I would really like to thank you all for being here. One is in Ireland, how dare she? But she did face time earlier today. And I can't tell you how much you mean to me. And some of you have been with me for a really, really long time. And what we do and who we are is family. So thank you for coming, and thank you for being a part of our crazy life for as long as you have been. I've tried to keep the politics of my speech simple and my remarks personal. But I have to end with some thoughts about the future. I, like many progressive Democrats, walked around after November, aimlessly trying to answer many questions, not the least of which was, what the hell just happened? And more importantly, what do we do now? How do we learn from what happened and not completely get sucked into the morass around us? And I keep coming back to where I began, maybe because it's the only thing I know. I know there are new techniques. I know there always will be new ways. I know you are all here to see all the new and shiny things to make our business run better, smarter, get more hits, whatever. But at least for me, I know how I got here. It wasn't ever about money for me, although it's been great. It wasn't ever about fame, although thank you again for today. It was always about what was the next mountain we needed to climb. What was the next issue we wanted to take on? It hurts my heart that it may mean revisiting some of the mountains we thought we'd already climbed and conquered. When I first started, like a woman's right to choose, for example. But if that's the mountain it has to be, then so be it. The good news is, we all know how to do it. We've done it before, and hopefully we have the stomach and the passion and the talent to do it again. Thank you so much for today.
Okay, thank you very much, everyone. Congratulations again to our honorees, who really are, I think, standout examples to all of us of the kind of people we can be, of the kind of consultants we can be, and of the kind of politics that we want to be able to do. Next sessions for APC members are separate caucuses for Democrats and Republicans. Democrats are meeting in the Two Harbors Room. Republicans are here in the Sapphire Ball. No, sorry, wrong. Republicans are where they were going to be, which is in the Emerald Cove Room. Afterwards, special session and happy hour hosted by DS Political on winning the California way. That's going to be in the Blue Room. Tonight, 7 to 9, we have a beach party hosted by our friends from Fox Sports. That will be from 7 to 9, oddly enough, on the beach itself. If you're facing the ocean, turn left. And you'll see a tent. We are a big tent organization. We will be having our beach party in that big tent. Thank you very much. Enjoy the conference.
What's going on? What's going on? What's going on? What's going on? Somebody tell me.